Welcome to today's broadcast of Wareham Gateman Baseball on Wareham Community Television. I am Samuel Corman, your solo broadcaster today here on WCTV. The Gatemen coming back home for their home opener today here at Spillane Field in Wareham, Massachusetts, after a splitting of a two-game road trip to start the season. Home opener was actually supposed to be last night here, but the rain washed out a game between Wareham and the Hyannis Harbor Hawks. So today, Wareham coming in facing a Falmouth Commodores team who has yet to get their first win of the season, coming off two losses, first to the Kituit Kettleers. We'll read through the starting lineups quickly. First, starting pitching for the Wareham Gateman is going to be Justin Glover out of the University of Georgia, lefty coming in here. Coaches compare him to Tom Glavine, which is a pretty high praise for a left-handed pitcher in anywhere. So a Tom Glavine comparison should raise the expectations for Justin Glover here today. A Buford, Georgia native, is a 2020 graduate of college. He's got a low 90s fastball, goes along with a changeup and a curveball. And this year he is 1-2 with a 3.94 ERA at the University of Georgia. Of course, the SEC is such a tough conference to play night in and night out in college, so a 3.94 ERA in that conference, certainly nothing to overlook as Glover takes the mound for his first start of the year. Also, it also was drafted in 2016 by the Tampa Bay Rays, decided to go to college instead of going to Tampa, however. So here he is in Wareham for his first appearance. We'll read through quickly the Falmouth Commodore lineup. Clayton Daniel will lead it off. He's number four. He's going to play second base today. Logan Davidson's at short. He's number six. Hitting third is going to be Alec Bohm, the designated hitter from Wichita State. Number 28, Willie Berger is at first. He will bat cleanup. Number seven, Zeke Dodson is playing third today. He'll hit fifth. Hitting six is going to be Joshua Bro, the catcher, number 32. Marty Beckenough out and right. He'll hit seventh, number eight. And hitting eighth is going to be Dale Wickham at center. And rounding out the Falmouth lineup is going to be Lee Solomon out in left field. We're just about ready for first pitch here. From Glover to Daniel, the righty. And it's low for a ball. So Justin Glover settling in here to this Falmouth lineup. Deals. Fastball low and inside. 2-0 count. Clayton Daniel, the current hitter for Falmouth, takes the first strike of the game there. On the inside corner, looks like a breaking ball. Nice pitch there from Justin Glover as he looks to settle in. Clayton Daniel out of Jacksonville State University in Alabama as he grounds one chopper to third. Played by Metz over to Cibole routine, and there's one away here in the top of the first. So right as I was introducing Clayton Daniel, he's the first man retired. He goes down 5-3, and that'll bring up Logan Davidson. Davidson coming into this game 2-for-8 on the season. Also a .333 on-base percentage. Glover has yet to pitch this season out of UGA. One of two UGA pitchers on this Gateman roster, along with Blakely Brown, the righty, as this one's fouled off by Logan Davidson. Davidson, a Charlotte, North Carolina native, goes to Clemson University. And coming off his freshman season, he was also drafted last year, but decided not to attend the minor league system of the Philadelphia Phillies, in which he was picked in the 30th round of 2016's MLB draft, as he takes a second strike on the inside corner. It's 0-2 now as Justin Glover looks to retire his second batter quickly. Just outside on that one. Looked like he might have had him. Glover's not going to like that one, but he's settling in here in the top of the first. The count's 1-2. Logan Davidson was actually the North Carolina Gatorade Player of the Year his senior season, as he strikes out swinging here on the 1-2 count. So Justin Glover on the breaking ball. Good sinking action there. Goes from the low part of the plate down towards the dirt, actually, and Davidson down swinging, so two down quickly here in the top half of the first. And Alec Bohm will step in quickly for the Falmouth Commodores. Bohm has been probably the best hitter in this lineup so far this season. As Glover, the lefty. First pitch flied out to right field. And Andy Shadid there to make the play. No runs, no hits, no errors. No man left here on WCTV. The Wareham Gateman coming to bat here for the first time at Spillane Field. Bottom half of the first inning beginning here in Wareham. Gateman up to bat as Falmouth went down 1-2-3 there in the top half. And Justin Glover made quick work of those top three Falmouth hitters. Brandon Lockridge has been a great story so far for the Gateman this year. He's going to lead it off today. Lockridge, a temporary roster player out of Troy University, a Pensacola, Florida native. And he's really impressed the Gateman coaching staff so far as he digs in. The righty takes from the right-handed pitcher Dalton Feeney, who's on the mound today for Falmouth. Feeney out of North Carolina State did not see much action in the ACC this year. Second pitch is flied out to right field. And Beckena there to make the play, one away quickly for Falmouth. So Brandon Lockridge decides to go up there and swing away on the second pitch. And he's quickly retired. Andy Shadid has also been another one of these temporary players who has really taken off here for the Gateman early on this season, just two games in, but he's 4-for-8 on the year with a double and an RBI, hitting .500 with a .556 on base percentage. First pitch is a breaking ball in the dirt from Feeney. Feeney just threw 14 innings this year for North Carolina State, but was one of the best players in his graduating class of 2016 in high school from Bismarck, North Dakota. Very rare that you see baseball players coming out of that part of the country, especially North Dakota. He was the top player as Shadid swings and misses at a fastball. Count 2-1 now on Andy Shadid. Shadid, the hitter out of Bradley University from Peoria, Illinois native. Last year played his summer ball out in Hayes, Kansas. He swings and misses at a high fastball as Feeney got him to chase hard on that one, so Shattuck now looking at a 2-2 count. One away here in the bottom of the first, no score between the Gateman and the Commodores. Shattuck takes a ball low. Looked like an off-speed pitch there from Dalton Feeney. Feeney's got a fastball, changeup, and a curveball. But most analysts would say that that changeup is his go-to off-speed pitch and not that curveball. And an inside pitch called strike three. Shattuck thought he walked, but he strikes out looking. So two down here in the top half of the first as a nice inside pitch there from Dalton Feeney jamming Shattuck. There was really nothing you could do but watch that one go by. Two down here in the bottom half of the first. Gateman lost 3-0 in their season opener, on the road in Hyannis, but then recovered in Harwich the next day, won 9-0. First pitch from Feeney to Willie McIver is a ball inside. McIver, the catcher today, has been in the lineup at third base most recently as he takes a breaking ball in the dirt. You see Feeney having a little bit of trouble early on controlling that breaking ball. He said that his changeup is really that go-to off-speed pitch. McIver takes outside. 3-0 now, very quickly, as we see Dalton Feeney really picking up the pace here for the Falmouth Commodores, throwing pitch after pitch. Hacking away on 3-0, sent out to center field. Diving play in center field made by Wickham. Oh, what a play out here in center. And that'll do it for the bottom half of the first inning. That was an incredible play. No runs, no hits, no errors on WCTV. It's 0-0 heading to the second. Welcome back to the top half of the second inning here in Wareham. We just saw an incredible play in center field by Dale Wickham for the Falmouth Commodores. We'll see him in the lineup hitting eighth, but right now it's going to be Willie Berger who swings at the first pitch and fouls it out over the third base side, or the first base side, excuse me. Got that reverse baseball field out here on the outfield. Looking in from basically your camera view right now is what I see with my own eyes is the lefty Glover deals, blooped into center field, and that one's coming on. And did he make the play? He did. Another great play. This time it's by Wareham's Nick Angelini in center field. We're seeing some great gloves early in this game, I tell you. Nick Angelini with a phenomenal sliding catch in shallow center, as that one looked like it was going to drop from Willie Berger. Digging in is Zeke Dodson now. Dodson, the third baseman, from Lipscomb University, one of two Lipscomb players in this lineup. As the pitch is low from Justin Glover. So Dale Wickham was the one that made that original diving play by Falmouth. As this one's grounded to short, Baird over to the first baseman, Cebul, and there's two away pretty quickly here in the second inning as the Falmouth Commodores are hacking away at Justin Glover. But relatively soft contact, that first fly ball was shallow center, and that one grounded to the third base side of the shortstop, Ben Baird out of Washington. So Zeke Dodson's retired. That'll bring up Joshua Bro, the catcher. Pretty quick at bats here early as both pitchers working quickly. Glover deals. Ball outside. Looked like a changeup to start off on Joshua Bro. We'll see if he comes at him hard with the fastball now on the second pitch. Popped up very high in the air. And the center fielder Angelini calls off his right fielder, or his left fielder, Topa, and that'll do it quickly here in the top half of the second inning. No runs, no hits, no errors, no men left here on WCTV. Welcome back to the bottom half of the second inning here in Wareham. Gateman and Commodores tied at zero. We saw some great defense back in the first inning from Falmouth's Wickham in center field, who we have yet to see come to bat. And in that top half of the second inning, we saw a good play by Nick Angelini in center field. So some quick defense here in this game as Dalton Feeney, the right-hander from North Carolina State, takes the mound for the second. Didn't have time to mention this crazy stat about him. He had a 0.17 ERA in his senior year of high school. That's a 0.17 ERA. How is that for a high school pitcher? We know a lot of these D1 players, especially in the ACC, they tend to dominate in high school, but I mean, 0.17 is just another level. This year at North Carolina State, a 2.53 ERA in just 14 innings pitched. As quickly, Jake Anchia is the batter. He's down 0-2. He's the designated hitter today after playing the first two games of the season at catcher. We've seen him in the cleanup spot every single time out. That shows that Don Sneddon has confidence in Jake Anchia's bat. And she is 1-for-4 on the season. Has also walked once, so that brings his on-base percentage up to a 400 so far. 2-1. Cracked into right field. Bekina there to make the play. One away here in the top, or in the bottom half of the second inning. Both pitchers delivering very quickly here. Not much time between pitches, as Blake Cebul will step in, the USC player. playing first base today. We've also seen him. We've understood that Blake Cibole can play both the corner infields and at catcher. Very versatile player, was one of the best in his class coming out of high school. Aliso Viejo, California. Hit 250 this year for the USC Trojans, and so far this year he's 4-for-9 with one double and one RBI. He's up in the count 1-0. Fastball just outside. 2-0. Looks like a pretty tight strike zone early on from the home plate umpire today. And Feeney chopped back to the pitcher. Feeney is going to play it. Fire it over. Off the bag. Did he get the tag? Yes, he did. A good play over there at first by Willie Berger. And Blake Cibole is retired on a rather errant throw by the pitcher Feeney. It's amazing. These pitchers so accurate with their pitches, but then when they're asked to throw over to first base for once in a while, they're kind of wild. But a great recovery there by Willie Berger over at first base to get that tag on Blake Cibole. Record that one 1-3 as Robbie Metz steps in, the third baseman from George Washington University, on the first pitch, chops to third. Berger, or Dodson, excuse me, over to Berger. And he's retired 5-3. Another 1-2-3 inning. We've had 12 up, 12 down here in the first two innings. No runs, no hits, no errors, and no men left here on WCTV. It's 0-0.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it's time to play the 50-50 raffle. This evening we're giving away 10 great prizes, including a Highline Canal Cruise for two, Woods Hole, Martha's Vineyard, and Nantucket Steamship Authority round trip for two, gift certificate from the PC Network guys, Friendly's gift certificates, Sand and Surf, mini golf for two, a dental back massage therapy gift certificate, Tucker Red Sox General Admission Seats, Highline Harbor Cruise in Hyannis, a pair of Tucker Red Sox Lux Seats, and of course the grand prize, half of the raffle's earnings. Tickets tonight being sold by Gaiman pitchers Mason Peel and Ryan. They will join by Gaiman interns Jessica and Emma. Take a chance, support Gaiman, and win some great prizes in tonight's 50-50 raffle.
Zach Brown Bench Chicken Fried brings you back into Spillane Field. Wareham Gateman and the Falmouth Commodores tied at zero, and we're actually in the top half of the third inning, even though this game has really only taken about 10 minutes so far. Pretty impressive pace this game from both the pitchers and the batters, who are swinging away at what seems like just about every other pitch. Marty Beckina is in the box, the Michigan State product. We'll see Justin Glover for the first time today, and he takes a ball up high. It's 1-0. Glover, the lefty, dealing very quickly. Another ball up high to Beckina, who is 3-for-7 so far this year, hitting .429 with one home run and two RBIs. One of the only home runs hit so far in this Cape Cod League in a pitching-heavy league. As he cracks one out to right field, deep. And running on is the center fielder Angelini, and he makes the play and crashes into the wall. Good play there by Nick Angelini out there in right center. And there's one away quickly here in the third inning. And seven up, seven down for Justin Glover, the UGA pitcher who's working through this Falmouth lineup. Also, Nick Angelini with a good play there. We've seen one of those on Joshua Bro back, a sliding play in the second inning. And Dale Wickham will step in. One of two Cornell players on this Falmouth roster. He fouls one onto the roof of Wareham High School. Or is that Wareham Middle School, excuse me. Middle School, not high school. The high school's a little bit further back in this complex. Pitch from Glover is once again swung on, popped up. Calling off Angelini is Topa, and he makes the play. Two down quickly here in the third. So, a tremendous pace to this game, as we can say. And Lee Solomon was second. I'm not even really getting time to introduce any of these players. That was Dale Wickham, who made that incredible diving play in center field in the first inning for Falmouth, who just flew out. He's a Cornell player from Victor, New York. And now Lee Solomon, the nine hitter, is already up here in the third inning. He'll step in. He's also from Lipscomb University, along with one of the other players in this lineup for Falmouth. Takes a ball, 1-0 from Justin Glover on the nine hitter, Lee Solomon. Solomon from Columbus, Ohio, was actually a 2016 Atlantic Sun second team all conference. And he hit 370 in 2016, which is an incredible batting average. 23 of 29 in stolen bases, 42 runs and 16 doubles this year for Lipscomb University, a part of the Atlantic Sun Conference. Solomon fouls one down the line as Glover continues at this very swift pace. Really looks like he has command over his pitches, although he has surrendered a few deep fly balls early in this game. Glover kind of reminds me of Roger Clemens with that big arm pullback delivery. Lefty. Lee Solomon played two seasons in the Great Lakes Conference, has swung on and missed, and Justin Glover strikes him out for his second of the day. First nine batters retired for the Falmouth Commodores. Gateman coming to back, trying to break this scoreless draw. No runs, no hits, no errors in that inning. WCTV, I'm Sam Corman.
Baseball Factory alumni have played on every Division I college program across the nation, plus 400 have made it to the majors. Visit Baseball Factory. Representatives will not be tolerated and are grounds for removal from this ball. And is embedded in all that they do. Curry prepares students to engage in successful careers and active citizenship with a global perspective. Explore undergraduate majors, minors, and concentrations.
The center back in the first inning is playing at the catching position today as the pitch from Dalton Feeney comes in high at the helmet, 1-1 on Ben Baird. Baird so far 1-for-4 on the season. As you see John Topa taking his lead over at first base, Baird swings and misses at a great breaking ball. 1-2 now. That one was in the dirt. Baird was chasing. So we'll see. For the first time, a pitcher out of the stretch today, Dalton Feeney. Working with it, checking the runner Topa over at first and delivering out of the stretch. Chopped to short. This will flip to second for one. On to first, not going to be in time, but they get the lead runner Topa at second. It'll be a fielder's choice for Ben Baird, and it'll stay with a runner on first. Now with one out here in the bottom half of the third inning, Nick Angelini is going to step in for the first time today now. So Ben Baird will now replace John Topa on first, and the fielder's choice scored 6-4. Angelini takes a breaking ball. Great pitch there. Got the low paint on the plate. So Feeney out of the stretch trying to command his pitches just as he did in the first two innings out of the windup. And like we said, he did not see much action at NC State as this one's chopped to second base. They had some trouble at second, and then they fire over to first, not in time. A huge miscommunication there by the Falmouth Commodores as the second baseman, Clayton Daniel, was looking to step on the bag, but Logan Davidson had already gone over there, the shortstop, to get the flip from him, and they kind of just stared at each other for a second, allowing Ben Baird to slide in safely to second. And Nick Angelini was already at first by the time they threw it over to first, so now there's two on with one out here in the bottom half of the third inning. We'll see how they score that. I don't really know if they can call that an error because there was no bobbling of the ball or a missed throw. It was just someone holding on to the ball for too long. So I'm going to go ahead and score that in E4 for now. We'll see what happens later. And it's scored in E4 according to our beat writer Matt Feld over in the press box right now, just giving us that information. Grounded to third, bobble by the third baseman Dodson, gets to third, not in time. So another error by this Commodores defense gives the Wareham Gateman the bases loaded now with one out here in the bottom half of the third inning after we had nothing going offensively on both sides before this. That was Brandon Lockridge. I didn't even have time to announce who was at bat there. Brandon Lockridge is going to reach on an E5. So two errors in this inning have the Gateman bases loaded. Andy Shadid in for the second time today. He struck out looking in the first. Now 4-for-9 on the season. Takes the first pitch inside from the righty Dalton Feeney, who's quickly facing some trouble. Feeney not getting a lot of time at NC State this year, but his coaches are really excited to see what this kid can do because there just wasn't that much on him when he came to the Cape this year. He's looked really good so far for this Falmouth team in practices. And they gave him the call here in their third game of the season. Andy Shadid, we mentioned, struck out in the first. Played his summer ball last year in Kansas, out in western Kansas, for the Hayes Larks, where he had a pretty solid season. The Peoria, Illinois native takes another pitch inside, called strike. Shadid not getting the benefit of the doubt on those inside pitches from Dalton Feeney, as in the first inning he struck out looking on one of those pitches very similar to that last one. So Feeney learning from that and trying to jam him inside on every pitch. Feeney deals. That one was just inside as looked like the changeup there. Coming into Andy Shadid. Shadid has a double and an RBI so far this year. And has had a 556 on base percentage coming into today. I would love to tell you what it is now, but I can't do that division right now. As the pitch in the dirt from Dalton Feeney, the count's going to run to 3-2 now on Andy Shadid. I believe this is our first full count of the day. Because there's just been so much first swing pitches and second swing at-bats as Shadid grounds that one foul. He'll stay alive. Now this is an opportunity that the Gatemen do not want to let slip away from them as, but the first game against Hyannis on Thursday, their issue was there are few opportunities they had with runners on scoring position against a dominant Hyannis pitching staff. They did not take advantage. As Dalton Feeney, number 21 in black, is going to deal towards the plate. The righty called strike three on the inside corner once again on Andy Shadid. And he's not liking that one as he strikes out looking for the second time. Two down. That's a big out for Dalton Feeney, eliminating the sac fly. Now any out ends the inning for Falmouth as Willie McIver steps in for his second at-bat. We saw him fly out to center back in the first. Well, that ball very well could have been an extra base hit if not for a phenomenal play in center field by Dale Wickham. As the pitch comes in the dirt, from Dalton Feeney to Willie McIver. We mentioned McIver has not played catcher yet this year. This is his first start behind the plate. Catching for that Georgia arm, Justin Glover. McIver was a 2017 All-Pac-12 honorable mention. And he's so important to this team because he can play the corner infield as well as that catching position, as well as Sable. So very important stuff there for Wareham. This one's popped down the line. Tough play for a baseman over first baseman over his head, but he makes the play. Willie Berger retires Willie McIver, and the Gatemen leave the bases loaded in the bottom half of the third inning. We'll go to the fourth inning. No score on WCTV between the Gatemen and the Commodores.
Welcome back. It's the top half of the fourth inning here in Wareham. The Gatemen on top of the Falmouth, the Gatemen and Commodores tied at zero. I got carried away there. The bases were loaded in the last inning. Excuse me. And it's going to be the top of the order starting off this fourth inning for the Falmouth Commodores as Justin Glover retired the first nine. So Clayton Daniel will step in for Falmouth. The Jacksonville State University player from Guntersville, Alabama. Jacksonville State, not to be confused with Jacksonville, Florida. It is actually in Jacksonville, Alabama. So many people confuse that. So I thought it'd be important to throw that out there, that Jacksonville State is in Jacksonville, Alabama. A much smaller and much less significant Jacksonville than the Jacksonville, Florida on the Atlantic coast. As the first pitch, a breaking ball from Justin Glover, the lefty, strike one. On Clayton Daniel, who has a 3.43 career average. Jacksonville State, a part of the Sun Belt Conference, popped up. And calling off the shortstop is John Topa, and he makes the play. Good communication there between shortstop and left fielder. And there's one away retired here in the fourth inning. It's Clayton Daniel that goes down quickly. Logan Davidson, the shortstop, is going to step in now. Clemson player coming off his freshman season. Had a .473 slugging percentage here in the 2017 college season for the Clemson Tigers. There's a breaking ball on the inside corner, strike one. From Justin Glover, who continues to wheel and deal here in this game, has a nice rhythm to his windup. He and McIver seem to be on the same page, despite the fact that they've probably never seen each other other than some practice before this game. Glover fouled away. You mentioned last time that Davidson was actually picked by the Phillies in the 30th round of the 2016 MLB draft, but decided to attend Clemson instead of head off to rookie ball or single A, wherever they decided to place him. And Logan Davidson's actually, as he takes a ball in the dirt, they say he went around on that. So, Logan Davidson strikes out. We were about to mention that Logan Davidson's the number six MLB draft prospect for the class of 2019 MLB draft. So, a very good talent there, although he struck out swinging on what looked like a check swing there, but couldn't hold up, so there's two away here in the fourth inning. And Alec Bohm will step in, another great player who I did not have time to address in the first inning as he flew out on his first pitch to right field. Glover, breaking ball, gets away from him outside on that one. But Alec Bohm was the hitter for Falmouth that we highlighted in the pregame. Last year in the Coastal Plains League, he won the Home Run Derby for the Wilmington Sharks and also had a .959 on base plus slugging as he testing out that power out deep to left. And at the track, made the play was Nick Angelini. A good play there. Calling off John Topa. The communication on point between the Gateman outfielders today. Now, once again, the Falmouth Commodores go down in order. We'll head to the bottom of the fourth with no score here in Wareham.
Coca-Cola, Bobby and Cape Cod, thanks you for supporting the Cape Cod Baseball League and for refreshing yourself with ice-cold Coca-Cola products. Please remember to recycle your empty bottles, cans, and all other recyclable materials. It takes only 6 recycled plastic balls to make a new baseball cap.
Getting ready here for the bottom half of the fourth inning, and the Gatemen and Commodores tied at zero. And we've seen some pretty impressive pitching, although Justin Glover, it's pretty interesting. We've seen a lot of deep fly balls against him. That last ball by the big power hitter on Falmouth, Alec Bohm, came out to the warning track here in left field, but nice play by the center fielder. Angelini getting over to make that play. As Jake Anchia comes in for the second time today. He's got that open stance slightly, has a nice upward stance and holds that bat pretty pretty high above his shoulder, unlike most hitters on this Gateman squad. Here's that open stance as he takes the 1-0 on the inside corner. It's 1-1 now on Jake Anchia, as you see the view from the press box. Anchia, 326 with 17 home runs and 15 doubles as he grounds one to second base. Daniel over to Berger, and one away. Jake Anchia is now 0-2 as he goes down 4-3. From USC now, it's Blake Cibol coming in here. He grounded out to the pitcher his last time up. He's now 4-10 on the season. But once again, we're mentioning how fast this game is moving so far. I don't want to set the tone too hard for this game. It's only the fourth inning, but we're already in the fourth inning here. As the first pitch to Blake Cibol comes in down low, as you see the Gateman fans, as that guy just picked up that dog. That was some impressive strength, I'm not going to lie. Ball comes in low in the dirt, and we'll get back to baseball. 2-0 here. I was just narrating what I saw on the screen. That was a very impressive strength by that guy, just lifting that dog and putting it on the picnic table there. Good work by the camera crew highlighting that. The lefty, Blake Cibol, on the outside corner, just outside. Count moves to 3-0. Blake Cibol was the seventh-ranked catcher in the class of 2016 coming out of high school, as he takes a strike on the outside corner. Looked like he was taking all the way on that 3-0 pitch. Also was an MLB draft pick before he went to college. 33rd round by the Cleveland Indians in 2016, but chose to attend USC instead. Just outside as he's going to walk for the first walk of the day for both teams. Blake Cibol was on first with one out here in the fourth inning. That'll bring up one of these Gateman veterans, Robbie Metz. Metz from George Washington University, one of two GW players for Wareham this year. Teammate Nate Fosnot not in the lineup today, but we saw him on Friday in Harwich, had a pretty good, solid game there, as well as the most of the Gateman lineup had a pretty solid game in Harwich, as they mounted 16 hits against the Mariners to get that first win of the year, that all-important first win. Metz was 2-for-4 in that game against Harwich with two singles. Also a run scored back in that 7-run sixth inning. He was the fifth run to come across the plate. Count 1-1 on him as he fouled that last pitch away over the grandstand on the first baseline. Last year with the Gateman was a West Division All-Star and had 37 hits in 38 games. The Poolesville, Maryland native. Can basically play anywhere on this diamond except for the catcher position, which is just so important to have on your roster as a guy you can just fill in wherever you need him night in and night out. And we'll expect to see Robbie Metz in almost every single game this year for Wareham as he takes a strike on the inside corner. 1-2 now. Metz 2-for-8 so far this year with an RBI. This season at George Washington, he had 23 multi-hit games. Just shows the kind of consistency he brings to the plate. Also has speed as he swings and misses on a high fastball. So he's down on strikes. The third strikeout of the day for Dalton Feeney of the Falmouth Commodores. John Topa, who has the only hit of this game, will step in, singled back in the third inning, but then was forced out at second base on a fielder's choice. Runner goes, pitching for a strike, throw wide and into center field, and staying at second is going to be Blake Cibol. We mentioned in previous games how the catchers on this team actually have tremendous speed, and there it is, Blake Cibol playing first base today, but is a true catcher, showing off that speed. Gets the stolen base there, although the throw came in wide. It looked like he might have had it anyway, though. So now a runner in scoring position. Fort Wareham. In a big position here for John Topa, who's 1-for-1. And like we said, he's the RBI leader with 2 early in this season. Let's see if he can add to that here. He's down 0-1 as that ball, that last pitch that was called a strike. It was right down the middle. Looked like Topa was taking all the way. Pitch inside on the inside corner. Another fastball there from Dalton Feeney, as it looks like his fastball has become his go-to here in the fourth inning. Right-handed pitcher now has runners in scoring position for the second time today after the bases were loaded on 2 errors in the third inning, although Wareham was unable to bring them across after Shattered struck out looking and MacGyver popped out to first. Pitch in the dirt. Count moves to 1-2 on John Topa as he tries to work his way back into a hitter's count with 2 outs here in the fourth inning. And a runner in scoring position. Falmouth Commodore is trying to collect that first win of the season. Upstairs. So now Topa working back into a hitter's count. It's 2-2. We could get a hitter's pitch here on John Topa, the UConn product. Teammates of another UConn player on this Wareham Gateman roster, Mason Fioli, who started the season opener at Hyannis. Pitch in the dirt, so now Topa, after 3 straight balls, now back to a full count. Big spot here for Topa with 2 outs, a runner in scoring position, no score here in the bottom half of the fourth inning. Topa, one of the lone returners on this roster, as we mentioned, Metz, the last hitter was, as calling for time is the pitcher, Dalton Feeney. Feeney gave up 6 earned runs in his 14 innings pitched for the Wolfpack this year. Just low, and Topa doesn't like that one, but it's going to be called strike 3. Topa down looking, the 4th strikeout of the day for Feeney. No runs, no hits, no errors, and the walk leaves a man on base. Here on WCTV, I'm Sam Corman. Welcome back to Spillane Field here in Wareham, Massachusetts. The Gateman and the Commodores tied at no score apiece. Willie Berger will step in for his second at-bat. Flew out to right back in the second. Fouls this one off from Justin Glover, who is dealing early on in this game. He's drawn 6 flyouts early on in this game, but has still retired the first 12 batters in this Commodores lineup. Willie Berger, a Penn State product, teammate of a Gateman pitcher, Justin Hageman. Lancaster, Pennsylvania native, takes the ball outside. 1-1 now on him as Glover continues this fast-paced motion of his. Throws a fastball in the dirt. 2-1 now on Willie Berger. Berger was with Falmouth last year. In 33 games, hit 4 home runs with 14 RBIs in a .227 batting average. He hacks on that one. 2-1 2-2. Glover swung on and missed as a fastball fooled Willie Berger. Very late on that one. Probably was expecting breaking ball on 2-2. And he's down swinging. The fourth strikeout of the day for Justin Glover. Dalton Feeney also with four strikeouts for Falmouth. And Zeke Dodson's going to get his second chance. He takes a strike as Glover really has his command going right now. Seems like every pitch finding a corner. And when it's not finding a corner, he's recovering on the next pitch pretty easily. That pitch just outside on the changeup, 1-1. Dodson, one of those Lipscomb players in this Commodores lineup from Tifton, Georgia. Grounds it to second in the outfield grass is Lockridge, throws it over to Cibole. And Zeke Dodson is retired. Two out here in the fifth inning. Joshua Bro, the catcher. Joshua Bro from McLennan Community College. Coming in here, one of the few junior college players we've seen in this league so far this year for playing for Falmouth. Bro, a Tomball, Texas native, which is in the Houston area. And a 401 batting average this year for McLennan Community College. 19 home runs, 82 RBIs. So that just shows the kind of numbers you really need for a junior college player to get here as a hitter in the Cape Cod Baseball League. 82 RBIs, not only that, 60 runs scored as he takes the 0-1 pitch, swings and misses at the dirt. Another fastball. Glover is just firing these fastballs low on this Commodores lineup, and it's just kind of fooling the boys in black right now. As Glover gets ready to face Bro, as Bro tries to slow the pace of this game down, steps out of the box, steps back in to face the dreaded Justin Glover, who throws a curveball in the dirt. Waste pitch there on 0-2. So Bro with those 82 RBIs and 60 runs coming in here for his first start of the season for Falmouth. So making his Cape Cod League debut. Takes a change up at the ankles. 2-2 count. So we'll see what Bro can do with that 401 batting average on 2-2. Slaps it into right field. A base hit for Falmouth. They're on the board for their first hit of the day. And it's Joshua Bro, who we mentioned had a 401 batting average in junior college. Gets the first hit of the day for Falmouth. They're kind of in business now with two outs here in the fifth inning. Marty Beckena comes in. He's 0-1, flew out to center back in the second inning. Marty Beckena, a career 262 hitter at Michigan State with 9 home runs in 52 RBIs in 2 seasons. Justin Glover, the lefty, out of the stretch for the first time today. Fastball on the outside corner, did not get the call, 1-0. Beckena, an opposite field hitter, so look for him to drive this one over toward Shadid or Lockridge. Take a strike on the curveball there from Justin Glover. Count moves to 1-1. Beckena, 402 at-bats in his Michigan State career in 2 seasons, which is a lot of at-bats in just 2 seasons. Can also run the bases, 17 steals on 24 attempts in his college career. Count is now 2-1 as you see the base runner at first base. It's Joshua Bro. Now you get the shot, hitter and batter. Glover, as this one's lined right to the shortstop, Ben Baird, and that'll do it here in the fifth inning. No runs on a hit, no errors, one man left. We will go to the bottom half of the fifth inning. No score here between the Commodores and the Gatemen. Dale Wickham is set to lead off the bottom half, I'm on the wrong side of the scorebook here. Ben Baird is set to lead off the bottom half of the fifth inning here for the Gatemen. The Washington product hit into a fielder's choice back in the third inning as back out to pitch is Dalton Feeney for his fifth inning of work. We usually don't see Cape League pitchers go this deep, but we've seen both pitchers make pretty quick work of the opposing lineup so far. Feeney did give up a single back in the third, and also two errors did not help the cause. But he was able to escape that inning scoreless, and then walked the batter back in the fourth, so he's given up just one hit so far as he heads out there, the righty. To face the righty, Ben Baird, the shortstop, is 0-0 on the day, heading to a fielder's choice back in the third inning. Change up up high, 1-0. Flown out and foul over the cage on the first base side. Ben Baird, drafted in the 20th round by the Cleveland Indians before coming to the University of Washington, will be eligible once again for the MLB draft in 2019. To the shortstop, Davidson, cross to Berger, and there's one away here in the fifth inning as Baird goes down 6-3. Nick Angelini reached on an error back in the third inning. He's playing center field today. And he steps in, the nine hitter, to face Dalton Feeney. Takes a ball in the dirt, off speed pitch. 1-0 on Nick Angelini from Bryant University. It's a Bedford, New Hampshire native. Fouls that one off the leg of the catcher behind him, Joshua Bro. Count runs to 1-1. Angelini's a career 333 hitter at Bryant with a 440 on base percentage and an even more impressive 940 on base plus slugging percentage. We'll get to more of that in a second. Over to the third baseman, Dodson, over to Berger, two down. Pretty routine chopper there from Nick Angelini. Brandon Lockridge is going to step in. First Gateman to see his third plate appearance of the day. Lockridge from Troy University, out of Pensacola Catholic High School in Pensacola, Florida. Fouls that one out near the Falmouth dugout on the third base side. Count goes to 0-1. Lockridge been one of the most important temporary players in this Gateman lineup so far, playing second base in these last two games and playing DH in the first game against Hyannis. Is 2-for-8 so far in his season. But he has that speed. When he gets on base, every single pitch, he's a threat to run the bases as he takes no 2. Grounds it through the hole. Tough play for the shortstop. Flying is Lockridge. Play made. Davidson to Berger. Side is retired on 3 consecutive groundouts from the Gateman. We'll go to the 6th inning. Still no score here at Spillane Field between the Gateman and the Commodores on WCTV. It's the top half of the 6th inning already here in Wareham. The Gatemen and the Commodores tied at 0. As a new pitcher in for Wareham after 5 strong innings from Justin Glover. And we'll get to that new pitcher in a moment. He's going to face Dale Wickham, the 8 hitter for Falmouth. Pitcher is Peyton Culbertson, making his first appearance of the season for Wareham. Culbertson out of Arkansas State University in Jonesboro, Arkansas. And watch the four pitch mix here from Peyton Culbertson. Gonna be hard for me to detect out here in left field, as Culbertson can go at you with that 91 to 94 mile an hour fastball, but also has that curveball, changeup, and then adds the slider in there. So 2 breaking balls for Peyton Culbertson, the Collierville, Tennessee native, heading into his junior year next year at Arkansas State for the Red Wolves. As Culbertson's going to face Dale Wickham, who flew out to left field back in the 3rd inning. Wickham, the center fielder who made that diving play in the 1st inning, Cornell University product from Victor, New York. Played right at home for the Victor Railriders last year in the Perfect Game League and hit 376 with 18 RBIs and 53 hits last season. Culbertson, 15 starts this year for Arkansas State as he throws an 0-2 pitch low. 1-2 now on Dale Wickham. Wickham yet to record his first hit of the season. He's 0-for-8. Culbertson. Pitch fouled away behind him. And Culbertson, that one looks like the slider may have came in from the middle of the plate into the inside part of the plate for Peyton Culbertson, who had 66 strikeouts to 32 walks this season for Arkansas State. And this one's fouled just over the windows of Wareham Middle School. Now, apparently, the windows are shatterproof over at that middle school. You can see the windows over there, but apparently there was an instance where one of the windows actually just completely came out, as baseballs do fly over there quite a bit off those bats of
the left-handed hitters. Wickham, pitch outside from Culbertson, 2-2. Culbertson with a 6.32 ERA. He is a full contract player this year for Wareham. Swing and a miss. Up high. On the fastball, two and on a 2-2 count. Wickham down swinging. That'll be the fifth strikeout of the day for the Gateman pitching staff as Lee Solomon will come in. As you get a look. At Mason Fioli out in the grandstand. First pitch inside to Lee Solomon, the left fielder who struck out swinging back in the third inning. Lee Solomon along with Zeke Dodson from Lipscomb University from Columbus, Ohio. Swing and a miss on a pitch in the dirt. Looked like a fastball there from Peyton Culbertson. 1-1 now. Spent two seasons with the Great Lakes League before coming here to Cape Cod. First with the Xenia Scouts back in 2015, where he hit 259. As that pitch is fouled into the corner off the fence and picked up by Andy Shadid out there in right field. And then back in 2016, played for the Southern Ohio Copperheads, in which he had a much better season, 376. With 21 RBIs in 25 games, this guy can run the bases pretty easily, I should say. 14 of 16 stolen bases back in 2016 summer. 2-2 pitch coming into Solomon. Breaking ball reached out to third base. And Metz fires over to Cibol to retire the second out of this top half of the sixth inning. Lee Solomon's 0-2.
The second baseman number 4, Clayton Daniel from Jacksonville State.
Now the leadoff hitter Clayton Daniel out of Jacksonville State will come back for his third at-bat, the first to have their third at-bat for Falmouth. Clayton Daniel's a guy that's been around. He is going to be a senior next year. Pitch from Culbertson, fastball up high. 1-0 on Clayton Daniel, who has a .343 career average with the Jacksonville State. Swing and a miss. Good pitch there from Peyton Culbertson. Looked like that changeup, one of those three off-speed pitches he has in his arsenal. 1-1. Fastball down low, 2-1 count coming up against Clayton Daniel, who played in 2015 for the Clarinda A's down out in Clarinda, Iowa, a small town on the Missouri border and just north of St. Joseph's, Missouri. And with Clarinda in the Mink League, hit .316, and also a guy that can run, hitting leadoff, 23 of 25 stolen bases back in 2015 as he works a five-pitch walk. So Clayton Daniel, the first player to walk for Falmouth and just their second base runner here in the sixth inning. And with two down here in the sixth inning, Logan Davidson has a chance with a runner on. So watch the speed of Clayton Daniel here with two outs in a scoreless game. You'd expect to see him make a run, especially with two outs, too. You expect him to maybe try to steal this base here as Logan Davidson will step in. Mentioned that he was the sixth-ranked MLB draft prospect for the 2019 MLB draft. Of course, those change quite a bit as the draft gets closer and closer, so we'll see where he ends up 2 years down the road, but certainly one of the top players and plays at a top program at Clemson with the Tigers. He's facing a 1-0. From the righty, Peyton Culbertson. Runner goes and grounded to second. Lockridge makes a safe play over to first, and that'll retire the side here in the top half of the sixth inning. No runs on no hits, no errors, and the walk leaves one man on base. 0-0 still heading to the bottom of the sixth between the Gateman and the Commodores on WCTV.
Roof Shirt Fridays is a national program created
to acknowledge, honor, and support our troops who put themselves in harm's way to defend our freedom. In support of this program, Gateway teams will be wearing a specially designed red jersey every Friday. This special weekly celebration of Red Shirt Fridays is sponsored by 47 Rand, HP Hood, Hickok Regional Transit Authority, Advanced Embroidery, and the Cape League. Support our troops and join us by wearing red each Friday.
Welcome back here. It's the bottom half of the sixth inning, and a new pitcher entering the game for Falmouth now. Tyler Blom is the pitcher. University of Maryland product entering the game as the second thrower for Falmouth. 2017 was 8-6 with a 3.48 ERA in a tough Big Ten conference. Struck out 71 while walking just 35 batters. And expect to see the fastball, curveball change up from him. His first season of Summer Bowl, as he's just a rising sophomore next year from Millersville, Maryland. And he was the second-ranked Maryland left-handed pitcher coming out of high school on perfectgame.com. But did throw quite a bit of innings for a rookie over at Maryland. 75 innings, gave up 63 hits. Also, the USA Today Maryland Player of the Year in 2016, so a very bright future ahead for Tyler Blom. Last summer played for the Baltimore Redbirds and went 1-0 with a 2.08 ERA. And there's no score here in the bottom half of the sixth inning. As Andy Shadid comes back in, has struck out looking twice in this game. But a big confidence builder for him to be back out there after facing the same pitch twice in a row. As he swings on the first pitch, drives it out to deep left field. At the track is Lee Solomon, who makes the catch at the warning track. Andy Shadid comes close there to the first Gateman bomb of the season. As this guy continues to wow the Gateman bench as they're all laughing as he runs back to the dugout. Shadid will fly out to left to Solomon, and now McIver steps in. Second pitch of the inning. Inside pitch from Dalton Feeney. He's been in the game for the time being, but it's now Tyler Blom. 0-1 pitch low, and now it's 1-1. Willie McIver, who is 0-2 today, flew out to center back in the first, was robbed, I should say, back in the first. As he swings and lines one into the right field for a base hit, Willie McIver on for the first time today, and now the Gatemen have a one-out opportunity here. Jake Anchia, the cleanup hitter, is going to be the guy to try to mount something here in the sixth inning. Jake Anchia has barely been at the plate today. He's 0-2, but I'm pretty sure he's only faced two pitches today. So we'll see if he has a more patient approach to the left-handed pitcher, Blom. First pitch in the dirt. Good play there by the catcher, Bro, though, to prevent that one from getting by him and keeping the runner, McIver, at first base. Jake Anchia from Nova Southeastern, a D2 school, as that one gets by the catcher, Bro, and advancing to second is Willie McIver on the wild pitch. important for Tyler Blom to collect his command now, as his catcher Joshua Bro is going to come out and have a conversation with him, kind of settle him down here, which is pretty interesting because the relationship between a pitcher and catcher is obviously so important, but here in these summer leagues, you enter the collegiate league and you don't even know who your catcher is most of the time. And in this case, it's a Maryland pitcher throwing to a McLennan Community College catcher. Pretty interesting stuff there, as we'll see what the conversation does. And Shia was taking all the way, it looked like, as stealing third is Willie McIver. Heads up play there by McIver, and now it's a 3-0 count, and McIver is just 90 feet away. One out here, and a fly ball should score that runner, as McIver does have some speed over there at third base. But Jake Anchia out of Nova Southeastern, a D2 school, actually won a D2 national championship. He takes a walk, and now the runners will be on the corners.
Well, first baseman, number 4, Blake Sabol.
In for the third time today, walked back in the fourth inning. Grounded out to the pitcher, back in the second. Has a .444 average coming into today. That fell down to .400 with that ground out in the second. But Sabol is a guy that you want to have in this position right now, your 5 hitter. And we know how good of a hitter he is, as he flies that one foul down the line over the middle school. Sabol with pretty good opportunity here. This not many opportunities of runners in scoring position so far for either team. Falmouth has yet to have a runner in scoring position, but now McIver leads off third with one out. Slapped into left field, diving play by Saltman, what a play! Tagging is McIver, he's gonna score, but a great play by Lee Solomon in left field to prevent that from being anything more. The second diving play for this Falmouth roster. And it was really nothing he could do about it. And also a very heads-up play there at third by McIver, not to take off there. Waited for Solomon, even though it looked like Solomon had no chance on that ball, but he made a great full extension at that ball. Dove and made the play. We're seeing some great defense out here in left. And Blake Sabol retired, but the Gateman just took a 1-0 lead nonetheless. So score that one, a sack fly for Blake Sabol. And Robbie Metz, the sixth hitter, playing third base today, will step in. He's 0-2. Pretty hard hack at that one. And it's 1-1 now, as you get a shot at one of the WCTV crew members here, repping that Boston Red Sox hat that's so common in this area. Robbie Metz facing the lefty. Grounded to the second baseman, Daniel, over to Berger. And that retires the side, but the Gateman break the tie finally here in the sixth inning. On a hit, one run, and one man left on base. 1-0 Gateman here as we go to the second inning on WCTV.
Attention, ladies and gentlemen, this is your last call to be a part of Atlanta's 50-50 raffle. Once again, this is your last call to purchase tickets for tonight's 50-50 raffle. KingCon Healthcare is the leading provider of healthcare services for residents and visitors of KingCon, with 2 acute care hospitals and more than 450 physicians. For more information, please visit KingConHealth.org.
Peyton Culbertson will dig in
to pitch for the Wareham Gatemen for his second inning of work here in the top half of the seventh inning. The Gatemen just took a 1-0 lead on a sack fly by Blake Sabol, his second RBI of the season. And the hitter for Falmouth is going to be Alex Bohm, the 2016 Coastal Plains League Home Run Derby champion at the plate. Flies one up the middle. Good play by Baird at short over to first. And one down quickly on one pitch here in the seventh inning. But Alex Bohm just rocketed that up the middle, and Baird with the shift on playing towards the middle barely had to move to his left. So Alex Bohm, one of the most dangerous hitters in this lineup, retired on one pitch. Willie Berger is 0-for-2, struck out swinging in the fifth inning and flew out to right field back in the second. Berger, the Penn State player, takes the 0-0, grounds it right back to Ben Baird, over to Sabol, and two quickly retired here in the seventh inning as Peyton Culbertson barely having to do anything for Wareham. Just a few pitches here in the seventh inning, and there's already two outs. Not to take it for granted, though. Any hitter in this league can make anything happen at any moment. It is where the stars of tomorrow shine tonight, of course. This is the Cape Cod Baseball League on WCTV. The Wareham Gatemen lead the Falmouth Commodores 1-0 here in the top half of the seventh inning. And Peyton Culbertson just deal the ball down low to Zeke Dodson, one of the two Lipscomb University players in this Falmouth lineup. Now 2-0 pitch coming in from Culbertson, as he hasn't commanded those off-speed pitches. A good pitch there, though, on the fastball. 2-1 on the inside corner. Dodson hacked on that one quite a bit. Dodson walked in 14% of his at-bats in college, so has that good eye as he swings and fouls this one out down past the first baseline over the fence. 2-2 now coming from Culbertson. Culbertson, the Arkansas State Red Wolf, facing a Lipscomb University infielder from Tifton, Georgia. This is popped up and into the crowd. No play there for the catcher, McIver, who's making his catching debut for the Gatemen after starting the first two games at third base. But Zeke Dodson, a 2016 Atlantic Sun all-freshman team player for the Lipscomb Bisons. A pretty interesting name for a team based in Tennessee is the Bisons, as there are no Bison in Tennessee. As he fouls this one off down the third baseline. Zeke Dodson, no relation to Gatemen pitcher and center fielder Tanner Dodson. Just a relatively common last name, as the catcher McIver has a quick conversation with Culbertson at the mound as a 2-2 count coming up. No man on, two out here in the top half of the seventh inning. Wareham leading Falmouth 1-0. Dodson 1-for-8 this year, with that one hit being a double. Fouls it out over the press box behind home plate. Count remains 2-2 as Culbertson works his pitch count up here in his second inning of work. We had a great start from Justin Glover as well as the Falmouth pitcher Dalton Feeney. Both performed well above expectation going five innings as Culbertson strikes out Dodson swinging. That'll do it for the top half of the seventh inning. No runs, no hits, no errors, and no men left for Falmouth. 1-0 Wareham on WCTV. We're back here in the bottom half of the seventh inning already here in Wareham. The Falmouth Commodores have not scored a run in 18 innings of play. They fell to the Chatham Anglers 8-7 in their opener, their home opener, on Thursday, in which they scored five runs in the bottom half of the seventh inning. But since then, they didn't score in the eighth and ninth in that game. They got shut out by Kituit on Friday, and they have yet to score here in the bottom in the through seven innings of hitting here against Wareham in their third game. So Falmouth really struggling with the bats against this very impressive Cape League pitching that we always see every year. As this one's flown out to center field by John Topa, and it's played by the center fielder Wickham, one away here in the seventh inning. But Falmouth having a lot of trouble with the bats, which is surprising considering how many good hitters they have in their lineup. But best of the best on the mound come here to the Cape each season. And it always seems like the pitching gets a little bit better of the hitting. And I have a theory for that. My theory is that it's the same pitching here as it is in college, but there is a major difference for hitters when they come here than from college. They're using a different type of bat, as Ben Baird, the shortstop, will step in for his third at-bat. So you go an entire season hitting with an aluminum bat. You have to come here to the Cape. Most of the time, it's just a few weeks or a few days after you finished your college season. And you're using a wood bat. And you have to make that adjustment against the pitching, which stays the same. Ben Baird takes the 0-1 upstairs, 1-1 now, on the Washington shortstop. 0-2 today with a fielder's choice and a grounder to short. Now 1-6 in the season. Takes a ball outside from Tyler Blom. Blom in his second inning of work, after Dalton Feeney gave Falmouth a pretty impressive start here. Flown out into the gap. Tough play. And calling off the right fielder Bacchino was Wickham, and he makes the play for the second out. So after Wickham retires, Ben Baird for the second straight fly out to center. Nick Angelini will step in. He is 0-1. Rounded up to third back in the fifth inning. Reached on an error in the third. Did not come around the score, as no one did in that third inning for Wareham. Oh, excuse me, there's a pinch hitter. Garrett Zeck is into the game now for the Gateman, replacing Nick Angelini in center field. That'll add some more speed to this Gateman lineup, as Garrett Zeck can really fly around the bases if he gets on. So he'll take over in center field for Angelini here in the seventh inning. Want to know. As you hear some action in the Falmouth bullpen. We'll get a name on that in just a second as I try to find what number that is in the Falmouth bullpen warming up. The pitch to Garrett Zeck in there for a strike. Tyler Blom is in pretty decent here since coming into the game for Falmouth. Gave up that sacrifice fly back in the sixth. Is the only earned run of this game. Pitch up high, 2-2. No chance on that one for Tyler Blom, as his command has been solid, but not quite as good as the starting pitching that we saw here in this game. As it is a 2-2 that hit him. So Garrett Zeck, I'm a little bit confused. It looks like Garrett Zeck was heading down to first base, but it looks like they might call that one a foul ball instead. So the count will remain at 2-2 on the South Florida product. Garrett Zeck comes into this game with one at-bat this year, 0-for-1. For South Florida this year, was 17-for-20 on the bases, on stealing bases. Hit, had a .260 average and went 2-for-6 in the Gainesville Regional in this year's NCAA tournament before falling to Florida in that regional. Florida, of course, advanced to the Super Regional to knock off Wake Forest and then to the College World Series. 2-2 pitch just up high. And that will be a walk for Garrett Zeck, so a dangerous base runner on with two out. And this is a time where you want to get a steal here. Get Garrett Zeck in the scoring position and give Lockridge a chance to knock him in, because a base hit probably scores Zeck with that incredible speed that he possesses. As we mentioned, 85% stealing bases. He goes in the first pitch, up high, and it hit him. So Zeck was going, but the pitch hit Lockridge anyway, so Zeck is at second. Lockridge goes to first, and there's now two on with two out. Andy Shadid's 0-for-3. He's going to step in, hit one back to the track out here and left back in the sixth inning. And here in the bottom half of the seventh, the Commodore is trying to calm down Tyler Blom, their pitcher, who struggled a little bit here in the seventh inning after getting two quick flyouts to center by Topa and Baird. He's now facing first and second with two outs, and Andy Shadid at the plate, 0-for-3 today. Swings and misses at a fastball upstairs. Shadid came into today, was the most recent Gateman player of the game in the 9-0 victory over the Harwich Mariners. Had two runs scored. Was also 3-for-5. Well, one pitch inside on Andy Shadid. 1-1 now. Breaking ball. We've seen Andy Shadid go down twice looking on inside pitches, so he's got to be careful protecting that inside part of the plate. Does, looks like he's having trouble understanding the umpire's strike zone today on the inside part of the plate. Shadid facing an 0-1 from the lefty Tyler Blom. Fastball got away from him in the dirt, as the catcher, Bro, is going to try to settle down his pitcher here. 2-1 count. Facing him with those two, with the two hands that we see so famously in the MLB and in most, in all baseball games, with, when catchers want to settle their pitcher down. Shadid facing a 2-1 pitch from Bro. Fouled back over his head behind the press box. Count remains 2-2 as you get the look from the press box behind home plate with that Wareham Gateman W lining the circle. Behind the catcher, Joshua Bro, and the umpire for tonight. That umpire is Jim Dion, the home plate umpire. 2-2. Up high, did he go? They go to the first base umpire? No, he did not. 3-2 count now on Andy Shadid, trying to avoid his third strikeout of the day with two out and a runner in scoring position. Another runner at first. It's Brandon Lockridge, Garrett Zeck, the pinch hitter, and now center fielder is the runner at second. Andy Shadid, 3-2. Two outs here in the bottom half of the seventh inning. The Gatemen lead the Commodores 1-0. Foul back behind his head over once again. Andy Shadid keeps the count at 3-2. And this will now be the eighth pitch of the at-bat coming up against Shadid. After most of this game, we've seen pretty quick at-bats from everyone. But Tyler Blom facing some trouble here in the seventh inning after he gave up a run back in the sixth. Grounded down the third baseline, bobbled quickly, then fired over first. In time. Dodson to Berger. Good play by Dodson to keep it in front of him. And they'll retire the side 5-3. They'll leave two runners on base on no hits. And we'll go to the eighth inning, 1-0 Gateman on WCTV. We're heading into the eighth inning already here in Wareham. The Gatemen on top of the Commodores by a score of 1-0. And trying to look at that number on that pitcher right now, but trying to tell if it's a new pitcher. And it looks like Peyton Culbertson back in for his third inning of work. Update from around the league, the Harwich Mariners on top of the Yarmouth Dennis Red Sox 5-2. In the bottom of the ninth, looking to get their first win of the season on the road. The Bourne Braves on top of the Orleans Firebirds, 2-0 in that game in the bottom half of the fourth inning. Just for reference, that game started at the same time as this game. We're in the eighth, they're in the fourth. Chatham and Brewster was canceled today, and so was Katuit and Hyannis. So three games going on around the league as Wareham looks. As the first pitch grounded up the middle, nice play by the second baseman Lockridge, but he bobbled the transfer. A really good play there by Lockridge to try and make that play, but could not get the transfer off cleanly. We'll see what they score that. Joshua Bro, who reaches. We'll get the official scoring on that in just a moment. Marty Beckina comes into the hitting in the seven hole today for Falmouth with a man on. This is just their third base runner of the game. Count runs to 0-1 on Marty Beckina. Peyton Culbertson in for his third inning of work. Facing Beckina. Out of the stretch, fouled off. 0-2. It's now Becca in a quick 0-2 hole, the Michigan State product. Mentioned Beckina is an opposite field hitter. Last year played in the Northwoods League for the Kenosha Kingfish. Went 3-16. But also a 908 OPS. They scored that last play, a base hit by Joshua Bro. It was an impressive play by Lockridge at second, just bobbled the transfer. So Bro on, that's the second hit of the game for the Commodores. As you mentioned, they have not scored since the seventh inning of their first game of the season on Thursday. And since then, they've played 18 innings. Grounded to short, bobbled by Baird, and he's not going to be able to make the play. That one will for sure be scored in error, as advancing to second is Joshua Bro. Bikina's on first on the E6. And that'll bring up Dale Wickman. And this is the first time the Commodores have had a runner in scoring position today, and all of a sudden the tying run is at second. So Bro advances on the E6. Wickham's on the E6, Beckina's on the E6, and Wickham now at the plate. 0-2 on the day. Peyton Culbertson now facing some trouble after a lot of not help from his defense.
Pitch in low, 1-0 on Dale Wickham. You know, it seems pretty crazy that we're already in the eighth inning of this game. The first the first four innings by the starting pitcher Justin Glover were perfect. And then the hit by Joshua Breaux back in the fifth, the catcher, broke up the perfect game, so to speak, for the Gateman pitching staff. Breaux now has both hits. Impressive stuff from the McLennan Community College product. He's 2-for-3 on the day. And Dale Wickham, the center fielder, now in a 2-0 count against Peyton Culbertson. Culbertson deals sacrifice bunt, trying to be laid down, but he missed. Wickham with a failed opportunity there on the sacrifice bunt. Now the count runs to 2-1. Wickham battled injury this year, along with a lot of the Cornell roster. They were an injury-battled team. So he only played 3 games this year, went 9-for-15, however, in those 3 games, so he can hit. Wickham showing bunt. Gets it down. And they're not going to get him at first. As a miscommunication there, we'll see what they score that one once again. A poor defensive effort by the Gateman there on the third base side. A miscommunication between the pitcher Culbertson and the third baseman Metz as to who was supposed to play that ball. They kind of bumped into each other as Culbertson was firing it over, and he threw it in the dirt. And Sable was unable to play it, so now the bases are going to be loaded with nobody out for Falmouth. So all of a sudden, in this pitching-heavy game, the Gateman pitching now in trouble with the bases loaded and nobody out. Lee Sullivan is the hitter. Swings and misses on a big hack on a low breaking ball, 0-1 now from Peyton Culbertson. Culbertson walked a batter back in the sixth, but then retired the next 6 batters he faced. He walked the batter in the middle of the sixth, retired the next 4 batters that he faced, but has retired 6 batters here today. And that pitch is going to hit Lee Sullivan walking in the tying run, and all of a sudden, the Gateman and Commodores are tied at 1 here in the eighth inning. Joshua Breaux comes around to score, the only hits so far for Falmouth are courtesy of Breaux, and he's going to get the first run of the game for Falmouth. So Dale Wickham advances to second. Marty Beckena advances to third on the hit by pitch. Lee Sullivan is on first. In the leadoff hitter, Clayton Daniel will face a struggling Peyton Culbertson. As here comes what appears to be pitching coach Jim Lawler on the mound to talk to Peyton Culbertson. And there's a guy coming out of the bullpen. So Culbertson's done here in the eighth inning after failing to retire the first 4 batters this inning. Not much help from his defense, but they'll bring on the replacement. And we'll go to break really quick here on WCTV. The Gateman and Commodores now tied at 1. The pitching change for the Gateman is Frankie Bartow, who comes in for his first outing of the year. And this is one of the most impressive guys in this Gateman pitching staff. We're really excited to see him pitch this year. He's on a full contract. He comes to us from the University of Miami. And the Miami native will now come in a pretty tough situation for his Cape Cod League debut. As the bases are loaded, and he'll face the leadoff hitter Clayton Daniel, who is 0 for 2 with a walk back in the sixth inning. Bartow had 71 appearances in two seasons. And he actually led NCAA Division I in appearances his freshman year. In 2016, had 43 appearances. And this year he had 12 saves and a 3.60 ERA for the Miami Hurricanes en route to a borderline NCAA tournament appearance. Just missed that cut of the 64-team field along with UConn. As the 0-2 pitch comes in, 1-2. Fastball, changeup, curveball for Frankie Bartow, the freshman All-American. Louisville Slugger, freshman All-American, that is, out of the University of Miami now on a 1-2 pitch. And just so you know, they scored that sack, that bunt back in earlier in this inning, a base hit, not an error, to the pitcher Peyton Culbertson. So that's just the third hit of the day for Falmouth. The bases are loaded here with nobody out, as Frankie Bartow is in charge of getting them out of this jam. No surprise that pitching coach Jim Lawler decided to go to Frankie Bartow here in this situation. Tough situation to be in. Why not bring in your most dominant arm? As that fastball in the dirt had Daniel chasing after it, but just fouled it off. Clayton Daniel from Jacksonville State University in Alabama. After he spent his freshman summer in the Mink League with the Clarinda A's, he went off to the Bethesda Big Train of the Cal Ripken League. That's an awesome team name. As the pitch from Bartow is driven out into center field, this should score a run. Making the play is Angelini, and tagging and taking the lead for Falmouth is going to be Marty Beckena. So Falmouth on top, 2-1 on the sacrifice fly to center by Clayton Daniel. Little small ball has Falmouth on top now, 2-1. So that run will be credited to the name of Peyton Culbertson. Although it is an unearned run, as Marty Beckena reached on an error. Dale Wickham was able to get to third on that sacrifice fly as well. So he advances. Remaining at first is Lee Solomon, as Logan Davidson steps in for Falmouth. Davidson been hyped up today for being a potential top 10 overall pick in the 2019 MLB draft, but is 0-3 with two strikeouts, both swinging, and ground out to second base as a fastball on the inside corner. Good pitch there from Frankie Bartow as he tries to get this back in. First and third, one out. And a double play would do wonders here for the Gatemen to get out of this inning, just surrendering two runs. As the pitch from Bartow in there for a strike on the curveball. Good pitch there from Frankie Bartow. We're going to be seeing quite a bit of this Miami righty coming in. He was supposed to come here with a few other of his teammates, but they decided not to attend Wareham this summer. Bartow on a 1-2 outside, 2-2 now. Logan Davidson, the batter. Logan Davidson's father actually also played at Clemson and then played 6 years in the MLB. Mark Davidson, if you recognize the name, former MLB player for the Minnesota Twins and the Houston Astros. He grounds one through the right side for a base hit. Scoring from third is Wickham. Advancing to second is Solomon. And on first now is Logan Davidson with an RBI single, and the Gateman trail 3-1 here in the eighth.
Designated hitter number 16, Alec Bohm from Wichita State.
And really tough for the Gateman pitching staff to watch this, as such a dominant performance early on in this game. Let's not forget Wareham retired the first 14 batters of this Falmouth lineup. And that was from the work of the starter Justin Glover, who then came out of the game, as most pitchers do here in the Cape Cod Baseball League, after maximum of 5 innings, pitch limits and whatnot, as the pitch comes in for a strike to Alec Bohm, who's very dangerous here. And with runners on first and second, watch out for this hitter. Alec Bohm out of Wichita State. Bohm is 0-for-3, flew out to right to center, and grounded out to the shortstop back in the seventh. Bohm to the shortstop, Baird, flips to second for one, on to first, the double play. Baird to Lockridge, to Cibole, gets out of the inning, and the Wareham Gateman trail the Falmouth Commodores 3-1 here. We'll go to the bottom half of the eighth inning. 3 runs, though, in that inning on 3 hits in an error. We'll go to the bottom of the eighth on WCTV.
We have 2 unclaimed prizes for tonight's 50-50 raffle. For the Devil Deck Massage Therapy gift certificate, it's ticket 9095922. And for the Woods Hole, the Martha's Vineyard, and Nantucket Steamship Authority round trip for 2, ticket 9096601. If you are still holding on to these tickets, your prizes are waiting for you at the merchandise booth. Learning and Curry College extends beyond the classroom and is embedded in all that they do. Curry prepares students to engage in successful careers and active citizenship with a global perspective. Explore undergraduate majors, minors, and concentrations, including new majors in accounting, biochemistry, and software development. Online at www.curry.edu.
Bottom half of the eighth inning coming up here in Wareham. This game started just an hour and 45 minutes ago, just about, maybe an hour and 50 minutes ago. And it's already the bottom of the eighth inning. Willie McIver will lead off for the Gateman after the Falmouth Commodores just unmasked 3 runs in the top half of the eighth. Tyler Blom back in for Falmouth. Has the first pitch to McIver is driven out to left field and a base hit for McIver. McIver's second hit of the day. Advanced to second on a wild pitch back in the sixth and then got to third. McIver actually was the scoring player on that sacrifice fly back in the sixth inning, so he's on with a chance to score again. And the Gatemen need that here, in a trailing by 2 in the bottom of the eighth. Score bug reads 2-1. There it goes, 3-1 now. Jake Anchia is the batter for Wareham, DHing today after catching in the first 2 games against Hyannis and Harwich. Anchia has been in the cleanup position all 3 games so far, as you see McIver leading off. That pitch on the inside corner. 1-1 on Jake Anchia. The 2017 season at Nova Southeastern had a .719 slugging percentage. We'll get to that in a second on what that means. 1-2 now on a great breaking ball there from Blom. 1-2 on Jake Anchia. Now the slugging percentage is a great stat because it tells you how many bases per at bat a player gets. And that doesn't include walks and hit by pitches, it only includes hits. So a home run is 4, obviously. And Anchia goes down swinging as he fooled him on that off-speed pitch. Tyler Blom has been phenomenal here for Falmouth since coming into this game. Blake Cibole walked in the fourth inning and had that sacrifice fly back in the sixth, so he has the only RBI of this game. McIver is leading off first.
after leading off this inning with a single in the bottom half of the eighth inning. Curveball low, runner goes, MacIver's in there easily. As we mentioned, the catchers on this team can run the bases as well. Willie MacIver flies down there to second. And now another runner in scoring position for Wareham. That's just... it's actually their third consecutive inning with a runner in scoring position. Last inning they failed to get Garrett Zeck across after he advanced to second on a Lockridge hit by pitch. So MacIver will lead off second now as Blake Cebol takes a strike on the outside corner. A good fastball there from Tyler Blom, whose command has been really, really good, especially out of the stretch, I've noticed. Tyler Blom's stretch routine seems to be fooling the Wareham lineup today. Leading off second is MacIver, and that pitch just outside on 1-1. Looked like Blom really wanted that one, but the count runs to 2-1 in a very important at-bat for Blake Cebol. MacIver on second after singling and then advancing on his own stolen base. Self-made play. 2-1. Just outside. Same pitch once again from Tyler Blom. Now it's 3-1. Missed outside on the same pitch consecutively there, just barely both times. As Cebol now in a hitter's count, we'll see what he tries to do. He's probably going to be swinging away here in the eighth inning with a runner on second. Although Robbie Metz is on deck, the veteran in this Gateman lineup. Slapped out, deep to left, and Solomon's going to be there to make the play. Returning to second is Willie MacIver. So Blake Cebol flies out. Two down here in the eighth inning. Robbie Metz now with an opportunity. Down by two here in the eighth inning. Metz 0 for 3 on the day. Grounded to third in the second. Struck out swinging in the fourth and grounded to second base in the sixth. Metz 2 for 11 on the season with one RBI. No runs scored. Pitch upstairs 1-0. Metz actually does have one run scored. I believe he scored back in the 9-0 rout of the Harwich Mariners on Friday, in which the Gateman pitching staff held the Mariners to just two hits as Metz fouls this one back over the first baseline bleachers. Metz, one of the returners from George Washington University. We mentioned that he is joined by his teammate Nate Fosnot this year. And Metz can also run the bases pretty well, so if he can get on base here, it's an important tool to have if he can steal at this stage in the game. Metz takes the 1-1 curveball low. Joshua Bro, who's done a great job behind the plate and at the plate today, reaches down for that one and grabs it. So the count runs to 2-1 as you get the view from behind Robbie Metz, the hitter for Wareham. Swings and drives this one deep to center field. And there is Wickham to make the play. So the Gatemen get a run here, or get a hit here in the eighth, but no runs. And they leave a man back on base. So we'll go to the ninth inning already here in Wareham. 3-1, Falmouth leads on WCTV. Thank you.
attention, ladies and gentlemen. Pitching change for the Gateman. Now pitching number 23, John Amendola from Franklin Pierce.
Welcome back to WCTV's broadcast of the Gateman home opener against the Falmouth Commodores. New pitcher in for Wareham after Frankie Bartow came in for relief of Peyton Culbertson back in the eighth inning and did a pretty good job. But Bartow's quickly out of there, and the fourth pitcher of the day, John Amendola will come into the game. Nick Angelini is a center fielder. So Amendola into the game from Franklin Pierce University. A Wallingford, Connecticut native down near New Haven. And in 2017, he went 7-3 with three complete games and a 1.62 ERA for Franklin Pierce. Transferred from Northeastern after his sophomore year. And he won a Connecticut State title, actually, in 2014 with Notre Dame High School. John Amendola in for his first outing of the season, wearing number 23 in white, that red Gateman written across the front of those jerseys, as the Falmouth Commodores lead the Gateman 3-1 here in the ninth inning. So it'll be interesting to see if Amendola is a late inning guy all season for Don Sneddon's club. But for Falmouth, it's going to be Will Berger, who's 0-3 on the day. First pitch from Amendola, up and inside, 1-0. No relation to former Patriots wide receiver Danny Amendola, of course, for John Amendola. As John Amendola's pitch is fouled away into the cage behind home plate by Will Berger. One zero is swung on and missed, and Berger's now at a 1-1 count, leading off the top of the ninth inning. The Gateman on the road tomorrow for a doubleheader against the Chatham Anglers. That game starts at 4 p.m., the second game at 7 p.m. Both those games will be seven innings, and you can hear both of them on the Gateman Baseball Network, audio only tomorrow because it is on the road. I'll be on play-by-play for that first game along with my partner Jacob Toby, and taking the play-by-play role will be Jacob Toby on the second game with Connor Federico on color. Of course, Connor Federico and Jacob Toby are broadcasting today's game on the Gateman Baseball Network's video feed for home games online. And you're hearing this right here on WCTV Wareham Community Television. A 2-2 count now to Willie Berger for Falmouth, who leads this game 3-1 in the ninth. Breaking ball swung on and fouled away once again. A good job by Berger to get a swing on that one. And that one's out near the Gateman batting cage. Berger is 0-3. The Penn State product played for Falmouth last year, hit .227 with four home runs and 14 RBIs. Four home runs in this league is not something to overlook. Grounded to third. Mets to Cibol, routine, and 5-3. Willie Berger is retired here in the ninth inning. Amendola gets his first out on the bump as a member of the Wareham Gateman. Zeke Dodson is going to come in, the Lipscomb hitter. We've mentioned there has been a tremendous pace to this game. It really has gone through and through the entire time, although we kind of just blew through the first five innings of this game. I believe it was about 7:10 or 7:15 when the fifth inning rolled around, just 40 minutes after this game started. As Zeke Dodson, the Lipscomb product, takes a strike on the outside corner, 0-1. Against the Falmouth Commodores, 5 hitter, who was 0-for-3 today, struck out swinging back in the 7th. Grounded to short and grounded to second. Billy gets a piece of that one, fouls it back on a changeup, 0-2. Amendola played last year in the NECBL for the Ocean State Waves. Went 4-3 with a 3.12 ERA. Struck out 31 batters compared to just 7 walks. Pretty impressive stuff from Amendola working his way into the Cape Cod Baseball League as he throws a ball outside. 1-2 now. Looked like a slider there. Slider again. Tapped out first baseline. Foul toward the Gateman dugout. So, Zeke Dodson staying alive here. Played 53 games for the Lipscomb Bisons in 2017. 37 RBIs in those 53 games, along with 63 hits. And a 312 career average among 2 seasons in Tennessee. Swings and misses in the dirt, and McIver will throw it over to first for Cibol, and the drop third strike retires the second batter here in the top half of the ninth inning.
The catcher, number 32, Joshua Breaux from Athletic Community.
So Joshua Breaux has been all over this Gateman lineup. We mentioned he's from McLennan Community College, and we understand how hard it is for players to get to the Cape Cod League out of community college. And Joshua Breaux has done it, and he's really making a name for himself in this game. His numbers in community college are just ridiculous when you really think about it. An over 400 average, no matter where you're playing in college, is very, very out of this world, I should say. So Joshua Breaux, who is 2-for-3 with a run scored, swings and misses on that 0-1 pitch. So now he's down pretty quickly, 0-2. Bro from Tomball, Texas, we mentioned. A Houston suburb just to the west of Houston, Texas. ...19 home runs and 82 RBIs in community college. Swings and misses at the 0-2. So great work by Amendola coming in here and doing his job in the ninth inning. The Gateman will have one more chance to score 2 runs in the bottom half of the ninth inning. You're listening to Wareham Gateman Baseball on WCTV. So Scott Mullitz is the new pitcher for the Falmouth Commodores as we enter the bottom half of the ninth inning. He'll try to close this one out for Falmouth for their first win of the season and improve their record to 1-2. I believe it was a recent addition to this roster. Mullitz, the righty, number 24 for Falmouth. Coming into this game, Wareham due up in this inning is going to be Topa, Baird, and Angelini. Excuse me, Garrett Zek was the pinch hitter for Angelini back in the 7th inning. He'll be due up 3rd. So the bottom of the order coming up for Wareham, but here in the Cape Cod Baseball League, the bottom of the order really isn't the bottom of the order, it's just the order. John Topa is going to lead it off from UConn. 1-for-3 today. As Falmouth finishes their warm-ups with Scott Mollets on the mound from Yale. Mollets making his first appearance of the season for Falmouth. And stepping in is Topa, who does have two RBIs this year. Singled back in the third, and then was forced out on a fielder's choice in that same inning. Struck out looking in the fourth and flew out to center field in the seventh. So it's John Topa to start this bottom half of the ninth. The Gatemen need a rally. And Mollets deals a strike, 0-1. Commodores in black. Fastball upstairs, fouled away by John Topa. 0-2 now quickly on the first Gateman batter of this ninth inning, needing a rally here. They were up 1-0 in the sixth inning, but then a tough seventh inning for the Gateman pitching staff, or eighth inning, excuse me, tough eighth inning for the Gateman pitching staff of Peyton Culbertson. Let this one get out of hand. Falmouth up 3-1. As the count runs to 1-2 as Topa takes the ball. Here's the pitch. Upstairs, framed well by the catcher, Bro, but not well enough to catch the umpire off guard, 2-2. Here's the pitch. Swung on and lined in the right field, a base hit. That's exactly what the Gateman needed. Here in the ninth inning, a leadoff base hit for John Topa. His second hit of the day, and Wareham is moving here in the ninth inning. Ben Baird's going to come up and try to do something with that leadoff base runner. So John Topa goes opposite field. Impressive at bat there. After falling behind 0-2 to work his way back and then get a good pitch to hit. Slapped the other way. Baird takes Mollets' pitch low in the dirt, 1-0. Baird 0-for-3 on the day, fielder's choice back in the third inning. Grounded to short in the fifth and flew out to center in the seventh as the count runs to 1-1 on Ben Baird. Baird from Washington. Teammate of the three hitter on this team, William McIver. Ben Baird swings and grounds this one foul down the third baseline. Count runs to 1-2 as the runner is John Topa over at first base. Actually, one of the only Gateman players in this lineup who wouldn't be stealing at will right now. A lot of speed in this lineup. Almost anyone can steal a base, but Topa is not one of the faster guys, as apparently Mollets doesn't believe me as he throws over to first base for a pickoff attempt. That may have been the first pickoff attempt of this game. That's how good the pace has been. Slapped into right field, a base hit. Topa's going to round second. He's going to stop there. Smartly, a great play getting it in quickly by the right fielder, Bekina. But it's first and second with nobody out here in the ninth and a rally coming. Potentially for Wareham. Two consecutive singles. All of a sudden, they bring their hit total from 3-5 just like that in the ninth inning. Down 3-1 here. Now the tying run is on first base, and Garrett Zeck is going to get his second at-bat of the day. Walked in his first back in the seventh inning, and then advanced to second on a hit-by-pitch to Brandon Lockridge. Lockridge is on deck. At second is Topa. Baird at first as the crowd gets into it. Showing bunt is Garrett Zeck trying to move those two runners into scoring position. And you know what? This is a great move if he does bunt here, because if he gets it down in a nice spot, Garrett Zech is probably outrunning this bunt. And here it is. Gets it down right in front of home plate. Zech flying to first. Can he beat it? And it gets away. Going home to score is Topa. Advancing to third is Ben Baird. At first is Garrett Zech, who looked like he was beating it out anyway. But scoring on the error is John Topa. And it's 3-2. And the tying run is just 90 feet away all of a sudden. So Garrett Zech with a sacrifice bunt. And then Topa will score on an error by the first baseman. So Garrett Zech at first. Ben Baird at third, a 3-2 Falmouth lead. And the big hitter right now is Brandon Lockridge, who's been in some big spots already this season. In the last game, Lockridge did single, also had a hit by pitch, and scored a run back in that game. Lockridge with no RBIs yet this season, but has two men on here. It's a 2-0 count now. Hitters count, runners on the corners, still nobody out here in the bottom half of the ninth inning. Is that runner at first? That runner at first is Garrett Zech. And if he comes around to score, this game is over. But then again, if that runner at third, Ben Baird, does not come around to score, this game is also over. Grounded to short. This could be two. Hits the shortstop on a tough bounce. It looked like that might have hit him in the head, and he's really in pain. That's Davidson. And this game is tied. The Wareham Gateman have tied the game as the shortstop, Logan Davidson, is in pain at shortstop. As that ball took a weird bounce, came up and hit him. You have to wonder what that might have hit in the infield as that took a crazy bounce, but it's Brendan Lockridge getting the RBI to tie this game. As now the trainer out to check on Davidson, we hope he's okay, as that ball took a crazy bounce. It looked like that would have been a double play, and if it had been a double play, this game would have been tied anyway. It would have been no runners on and two out. But instead, we have first and second, nobody out, and the Gatemen and Falmouth Commodores are all of a sudden tied here in the ninth inning as they check on Logan Davidson at shortstop. You mentioned how good of a player Davidson was many times in this game. He is a potential top 10 draft pick in 2 years. Right now, he's ranked that way at least. Comes from a long line of baseball as his dad was a World Series champion in 1987 with the Minnesota Twins. The former Phillies draft pick is going to shake this one off. Looks like he's staying in the game. So Logan Davidson got hit in the head off a crazy bounce there. And the RBI single from Garrett Zech ties this game. Andy Shadid with runners at first and second and nobody out here in the bottom half of the ninth steps in. Shadid is 0 for 4 today. Struck out looking twice in the first and the third. Flew out in the sixth and grounded to third. I'm not going to lie, I was sitting this entire game up here in the booth. I am now on my feet out here in the outfield trying to get a better look at Andy Shadid. Shadid, one of the temporary roster players at a Bradley University, has a chance to be the hero here. But with zero outs and a 1-1 count, we'll see if he shows bunt. Try to move that runner over to third for Willie McIver. And Shadid is going to show bunt. Gets it down but goes foul. He's not going to be happy with that one. Tried to chase it outside the zone. Looked like it might have been a little bit outside if had he not chased it. So Shadid now in a 1-2 count. Garrett Zech is at first. He has wheels. And when I mean wheels, basically any time he tries to steal a base, he's probably going to steal the base. At second is Ben Baird. Or excuse me. At second is Garrett Zeck, has wheels. At first is Brandon Lockridge, who also has wheels. Huge wheels around the bases for Wareham. Fireworks going off in the distance. But right now, Andy Shadden has work to do for Wareham. 1-2 pitch taken low. Good eye there from Shadden on a tough pitch to lay off of on a pitcher's count. 2-2 now in this big situation for the former Hayes Lark of the Jayhawk League. Shadden at Bradley University this year. Cracks one to second. At second for one, on to first, a double play. The runner advances to third. But Lockridge and Shadden are retired, and now the winning run of Garrett Zeck is at third base, and Willie McIver has a chance to be the hero. So a 6-4-3 double play for Andy Shadden. Willie McIver takes the ball low. 1-0. Big situation here. The go-ahead run at third base as the night starts to take over Wareham on this Saturday night, the home opener. Wareham and Falmouth tied at 3. The Gatemen got out to a 1-0 lead in the sixth inning before Falmouth exploded for 3 runs in the eighth off of Peyton Culbertson of Arkansas State. And here in the ninth, John Topa and Ben Baird have come around to score for a ninth inning rally for the Gatemen, and we're all tied up. Pitch comes inside. On the corner, 1-2. William McIver. The Washington catcher playing catcher today after playing third base in the first two games. Hitting. He is 2-for-4 on the day. Grounds it slowly. Past the pitcher. Can he get it to first? No, he can't. The game is over. The Gatemen win on a walk-off RBI single by Willie McIver, the catcher. Coming around to score on that one was Garrett Zeck, and the Gatemen with a ninth inning rally have taken this one 4-3 here at Spillane Field in the opener. What a game we had here after Falmouth exploded for 3 in the eighth. The Gatemen come storming back in the ninth against Scott Mowitz, the Yale pitcher, and take this one 4-3, advance to 2-1 on the season. And if you're the Falmouth Commodores, that one has to hurt. Already 0-2 on the year, and then to come into Wareham and to be 3 outs away from that first win of the season, they come up short today as William McIver, the hero, gets the walk-off RBI single.
Join us for our next home game here at Spillane Field on Monday night, June 19th, as the Gatemen play host to the Highlands Harbor.
And the Gatemen tomorrow will head to Chatham for a doubleheader. Then they'll come back home on Monday, or excuse me, on Tuesday. We have an off day on Monday, but they'll come back home on Tuesday as the Gatemen advance to 2-1 on the season on a walk-off single by Willie McIver. We saw some great starting pitching from today from Justin Glover. Peyton Culbertson came in today, struggled a little bit at the end. Frankie Bartow got him out of that eighth inning jam, and John Amendola came in and threw a perfect ninth to get the Gatemen into position to get that opportunity in the bottom of the ninth, down by 2 runs. It was Topa and Barrett that started this inning with a single, with 2 consecutive singles. Garrett Zeck then followed it up with a bunt single that got by the pitcher. And after Brandon Lockridge reached on a single off the face of the shortstop, Logan Davidson, it was Andy Shadden's 6-4-3 double play that moved Garrett Zeck over to third base, and then William McIver on the infield single wins the game for Wareham. Thank you for listening to today's broadcast of Wareham Gateman Baseball on WCTV. For Sam Corman and WCTV, thank you.